Last class, let us illustrate by some numerics. So, I will increase the time. So, this is effectively the let me make it bigger so that you can see it easily. Yeah, I'll make it slower so that you can see the evolution easily. Fine. Now, here are the parameters, and what I'll do first is that I will reduce the parameter to something below 24 at which it was supposed to set in. Say, let me put it at 10 and close it. And I'll start it again. No, it has come back to 28 now. So, now you can see that it is, I will make it a little faster, it is a bit slow. What kind of eigenvalue does it have? Complex conjugate with negative real part. Can you see the plane? Right? You can see the plane, right? Good. So, you now know that this is one equilibrium point. Fine. I will put another orbit with a, this was 15, 10, 40, I will start with say minus 15, 10, 40 and then see from two different initial conditions, they go to two different equilibrium points. Can you now see the two different eigenplanes? Yeah. Now, as we increase the parameter to say 20, it will you can see that it is still converging inwards, but the rate of converging is less. How do you interpret it in terms of the eigenvalues? It still has a negative real part, but the real part is smaller. So, that is, I mean, this kind of visual impression I am trying to develop in you. And then, as I increase the parameter to a value that is say beyond 24, I'll better delete one so that you can start with one of them. So, this one is there, I will just show one. So, it is going outwards and then it goes to the other one. So, you see if I increase the time, then it will be run for a longer time, it will be easier to see. So, you can see that it is going out in one eigenplane and getting thrown into the other eigenplane, again going out, getting thrown into the other eigenplane and so on and so forth. You can see that still unable to go out. Clear? So, one eigenplane is here, another eigenplane is here, and this mechanism is what is creating the chaotic behavior. Okay. Now, let me illustrate what I mean by the sensitive dependence on initial condition. Let me, you can see the x coordinate is 15, 10, 40 is the initial condition, right? I start another with 10, 40, but here in place of 15, I put 15 point, how many zeros you want? Happy? Okay. Now, there is practically no difference between the two initial conditions. So, let me start with this initial condition, let me go on, let us see what happens. You can see that it is only one color because they are going together, that is what is expected to happen. So, that is what is happening. So, the two initial conditions are yet leading to the same behavior, but slowly the colors will start emerging and then see now there are two different orbits and after some time they will go in different loops. Okay. So, which means that even though you start from arbitrarily close initial conditions, they ultimately move apart. It means that in such systems prediction is futile, you cannot predict, because when you try to predict, what you do, you write down the differential equations, which we did, you plug in the initial conditions, which we did. But you know that when we plug in the initial conditions, the actual initial condition could be slightly different from what you plug in, and that will make your prediction impossible. Not only that, there is even more deeper meaning to the story. When you actually put in the initial condition, you are putting in a real number, and the real numbers when you put into the computer is always finite size, which means that there are certain digits you are always ignoring, right. And even this small amount of difference will make the prediction impossible. And this is sometimes called the butterfly effect, which means that if there is a butterfly moving its wings in Calcutta, they can cause a hurricane somewhere in the United States. So, it is a metaphor, but actually maybe nothing like that really happens, but the point is that a slight perturbation somewhere can lead to a widely different. The character of the chaotic system. Okay, so this is something I wanted to illustrate so that you can. Okay, let me also illustrate that this is not the only mechanism of chaos, creation of chaos. I'll illustrate one more possible mechanism. See here, you can easily see that there is a equilibrium point sitting here, which has an eigenplane like this, and this has eigen eigenvalues with positive real part, so that it is going outgoing, but as it goes out, it gets thrown out of the plane and then it brings it in the plane. So, it is just one equilibrium point, but still that can create chaos. So, as it goes out, it gets thrown out and it comes in and again gets outward. So, there can be various different mechanisms of chaos. I have just illustrated two mechanisms by which you can have sensitive dependence on initial condition, you can have bounded orbit yet aperiodic. Okay. So, now let us go to maps. Where were we? We were here. We are here, yeah. Well, one very common way of handling such systems or such dynamics is something that was invented by Henri Poincaré. He proposed to place an imaginary plane in the phase space called the Poincaré section, so that the orbit intersects it. As it goes around, it intersects it. So, if there is a pointer, yes. So, it intersects, the arrow will be opposite. It intersects and goes around. So, if you look at it in every piercing from one side, then you might say that this point maps to this point, right. So, on the plane, if you are an ant sitting on this plane, you will not see what is happening elsewhere. You will only see a point piercing, going to another point piercing, and that is going to third point piercing, and so on and so forth. In the plane, there are two coordinates x and y, and therefore it will be like x n plus 1 y n plus 1 is a function of x n y n, right? So at the nth iteration, if the piercing is at a point x n y n, in the next iteration the x n plus 1 y n plus 1 will be a function of x n y n, right? So now it is a discrete dynamical system because it is hopping discretely from one point to another. That is called a map. So a map is essentially a representation of a dynamical system, which is actually maybe represented by a set of differential equations, but this gives a far more easily handleable form by which we can work. So if you have a map somehow, if suppose you have obtained a map of the system, then you can repeatedly apply, and if you repeatedly apply, you will get a sequence of points, and that sequence of points can be a convergent sequence, and if it is a convergent sequence, it will converge onto a point. The point will have the property that starting from the point, apply on the map, it will come to the same point, right? That is called a fixed point of a map. So if it is a convergent sequence, that converges onto the fixed point of the map. So the fixed point is given by x n plus 1 is equal to x n, y n plus 1 is y n. And on the Poincare section, a period 1 orbit, period 1 limit cycle will be equivalent to just a point, just a fixed point. Okay? If you perturb it from here, from part of the initial condition from here, it will pierce it repeatedly, creating a sequence of points that converges onto this point, right? If you have a period 2 orbit, it will be represented by 2 points on the Poincare section. If you have period 3 orbit, 3 points. If you have a chaotic orbit, an infinity of points. Okay. But those infinity of points will be scattered in a way that has a geometrical structure and shape. That often talks about the character of the system. What will happen if you have a torus and if you place a Poincare section? You will get a closed loop. So having a closed loop on the Poincare section implies that in the actual differential equation system, there is a torus. Okay. But then we have already seen that these two frequencies can be commensurate or incommensurate. If it is commensurate, then there will be a finite number of points on this loop, and if it is incommensurate, there will be infinite number of points on this loop. So these are the two representations of a movement on a torus in the Poincare section. In the Poincare section, in both cases, they will be placed on a loop. Okay, so now let us come to how to understand dynamics with one-dimensional map. One thing you might notice that if you place the Poincare section on the phase space, then the Poincare section's dimension is one less than that of the phase space. So if the original system was two-dimensional, the Poincare section will be one-dimensional, so you will give a one-dimensional map. If the original system was three-dimensional, you will give a two-dimensional map, and so on and so forth. So it results in some simplification in terms of dimensionality. So you have a, suppose a map which I started with, remember this map I started with, that is the logistic map that represented the dynamics of a fish population in a pond. We started with that, so this is that map. One nice thing about the one-dimensional maps is that its graph can be drawn. So you can draw the graph of the function. In this case, a graph looks like this. Put x n is equal to 0, x n plus 1 will be 0, x n equal to 1, x n plus 1 will be 0, and so on and so forth. At 0.5, we get the highest point. You can plot it. Another nice thing is that geometrically you can identify the fixed point. The fixed point will have the property that x n is equal to x n plus 1, and that is the point on the 45 degree line, right? So wherever this graph of the map intersects the 45 degree line, that will be the fixed point. And in this case, I can see that easily, geometrically I can see that there is one fixed point here, another fixed point there. There are two fixed points. And then we have also have to talk about the stability of the fixed points and so on and so forth. But another nice thing about this one dimensional map is that even you can work out the whole dynamics graphically. You do not have to do it by moving your pen, you can only move your thoughts. See, this is the graph of the map. Suppose the initial condition is here. So, you are asking where will the next iteration be? You go up to the graph of the map and come to the 45 degree line, wherever it comes, that is the point at which it maps. Now, if you repeatedly want to iterate, start from this point, go to the graph of the map, go to the 45 degree line, this is where your next point is, so on and so forth. So, you can graphically iterate, simply do this. And this kind of graphical iteration is called a cobweb diagram, because it looks like a cobweb. So, it is called a cobweb diagram. This is a very convenient way of working out the dynamics of a system without ever doing any mathematics. You can easily do it completely graphically. So, this we will be using repeatedly in our course. So, it is nice to get used to this cobweb diagrams. We need to also talk about the stability of fixed points. For example, I know a fixed point is sitting here, another fixed point is sitting here. Are they stable or unstable? Now, in order to do that, let us look at the local linear neighborhood of this. It can be approximated by a straight line here. It can be approximated by a straight line here, right? So, if you approximate by a straight line, by this cobweb diagram logic, can we work out under what condition a fixed point will be stable or unstable? Yes, we can. For example, suppose the graph of the map in the local linear neighborhood is like this, and this is the 45 degree line. Start from initial condition here. How do you iterate? Go to the graph of the map, go to the 45 degree line, go to the graph of the map, go to the 45 degree line, so on and so forth. You can see that that automatically is leading towards the fixed point, right? Therefore, this fixed point is in this case stable. But then, if you have this as the graph of the map and this as the 45 degree line, which means the slope is bigger than 1, then start from here, you will find tick, 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 it is actually going away. So, this leads to the conclusion, simple logic, that if the slope is bigger than 1, then it is unstable. Slope is smaller than 1, it is stable. Notice the difference. In case of a differential equation, a set of differential equations, what was the condition for stability? The real part of the eigenvalue should be negative. While in this case, what is the condition for stability? That its value should be smaller than 1. So, in case of map, the condition is a bit different. Okay, if the slope is negative like this, then it is a bit different. Notice that if you start from here, it goes like this to the graph of the map, and in order to go to the 45 degree line, goes to the other side, again to the graph of the map, other side. What is happening? There is a buildup of sound. Okay. So, you can see it is going around and it is converging onto the fixed point, therefore, it is stable. But this is the situation where the derivative is between minus 1 and 0. And if the derivative is smaller than minus 1, which means the slope is larger than 1, then you will see it goes around like a cobweb, but it goes out. Therefore, it is unstable. So, this leads us to the conclusion that the condition for stability in this case, the modulus should be smaller than 1. Okay, that is the condition for stability. And this fixed point is representative of the stability of that limit cycle from which it was obtained, right? So, this is a nice and easy way of understanding the stability of the fixed point. The bifurcation diagram is a very convenient way of understanding almost everything about the dynamical system, the stability status, as a parameter is varied. Suppose you have a map something like this, and you are trying to obtain its behavior as the parameter is varied. What we normally do is that we iterate the map for a long time, we eliminate the initial transient, because we want to plot only the steady state behavior. And then, if all the points fall at the same value, then you just plot one point here. But then you are essentially iterating for a long time and plotting only the last part. Therefore, it has, you assume that it has reached a stable behavior, then you plot it. Suppose it has got like this, what does it interpret as? See, suppose this point, it means that all those points fell on the same point and therefore, it is just a period 1 behavior. So, you would interpret that in the differential equation system, it was a period 1 behavior. While here, it goes from 1 tick, 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 like that, there are 2 points and it toggles between the 2. Therefore, it is nothing but a period 2 orbit, it is like this. And if you take a place a Poincare section, one intersects here, again intersects there, again intersects here, again intersects there. So, it is a period 2 orbit. Then it goes into a period 4 orbit. Then it goes to a period 8 orbit. So, it goes through a sequence of period doublings, period 1 to 2 to 4 to 8 and so on and so forth. And then ultimately, that sequence obviously will lead to period infinity, and that is what happens here. It becomes chaotic. Okay. This kind of diagrams are very important in understanding the bifurcations of the system, and so these are called bifurcation diagrams, and this immediately raises a few questions. Can you look at this and ask some questions? Some why questions, why does it happen kind of questions? A, why is nothing there before this point? Why does it go into a period doubling? Why? Right? Why does it go into chaos? And inside the chaos, why do I see this, you know, white patches? Natural questions, right? The moment you plot these natural questions come and we need to answer them. Okay, let's go one by one in answering each of these questions. But cultivate the habit of asking these questions. I should not ask the question, you should ask the questions. Okay. First, the map was like this, given by this functional form. Where are the fixed points? Quickly do it. You put this to the same value and that gives a quadratic equation, and the quadratic equation will have a solution like this. This is the location of the fixed point. Now, the location of the fixed point has a square root term, and obviously, the thing under the square root, if it is negative, then it will be a complex number, but this has to be a real number because it is a location in the real value space. So, if that happens, then we would conclude that the fixed point does not exist. And we can see that so long as A is below minus 1 by 4, then it that particular condition happens and it is does not exist. When it is bigger than minus 1/4, then it starts to exist, but then plus and minus 2 values, right? There are 2 values. So, immediately just calculation of the fixed point tells us that below a certain critical value, the fixed point will not exist. Above a certain critical value, 2 fixed points will exist, not 1. 2 fixed points will exist. And that is exactly what happens here. A fixed point starts to exist. Notice the way we have drawn is that we have started from any arbitrary initial condition and we have waited for calculated the iterators for a long time, then eliminated the transient. So, we can only see the stable fixed point, we cannot see the unstable fixed point, right. So, you are seeing one, but theory will tell you that there must be another which is unstable. Which actually goes like this, but this is unstable fixed point. Graphically, it was like this when it was below 1/4, and then at this point it made contact, and then it sort of went through creating 2 fixed points. Do you see that? Below a certain value there will be no fixed point, no intersection. Above a certain value, there will be 2 fixed points. Obvious. And this is no rocket science, this is very simple. And it is also clear immediately that one of the fixed points will have a slope that is smaller than 1, the other must have a slope that is bigger than 1. Therefore, one should have to be stable, the other has to be unstable. This one that is stable is called a node, stable node, and this one that is unstable is called a saddle. That is why the bifurcation that took place here is called a saddle node bifurcation. Okay. So, the take home message is that whenever in a system you see that below a certain parameter value no fixed point exists, not only unstable, exists, and beyond a certain parameter value fixed points begin to exist, that is a saddle node bifurcation. Okay, let us come to the period doubling. Look at this. The stability of this one will be given by the slope here, and as the slope increases, as the parameter increases, this one goes up, and naturally at some point it will be like this. So, there will be a negative slope, and when the negative slope is bigger than 1, then it will lose stability. Let us see what happens then. No problem, I have to just press this, that is the problem. Okay. So, we calculate the slope, which is nothing but the derivative at the equilibrium point. So, we calculate the derivative and plug in the position of the equilibrium point, and we get this. So, it tells us that between this range, the magnitude of the derivative is less than unity and the fixed point is stable, and if it goes beyond this value, then it is unstable. What happens when it becomes unstable? For that, what we do is to calculate the second iterator of the map, x n plus 2 as a function of x n. That is easy, because x n plus 2 is the same function of x n plus 1, and in place of x n plus 1, we plug in the x n here, so that it becomes a fourth order equation, and then we put this equal to this, so that you get a equation to solve. And if you plot this function, then you get this. So, the actual graph of the map was like that, but the second iterate of the map has a shape like this. You notice that so long as the graph, the slope of the map is smaller than 1, this one also has a slope that is smaller than 1. So, this point is stable, nice. But then when this slope becomes bigger than 1, then this one gets a slope that is bigger than 1. And then obviously, and almost by common sense, there must be 2 points here that will intersect at the 45-degree line. And both these points must have slope that is smaller than 1. Therefore, these are 2 stable fixed points. So, when this fellow becomes unstable, a period 2 orbit must come into existence. So, if a fixed point, if that comes, that loses stability, there is a period 2 orbit that must come into existence. Okay? So, that is the period doubling. Let me show it with the program that I have. Graphical analysis. So, the crop wave diagram, it automatically draws the crop wave diagram. So, let me show it. It started from this value and it went around, it is a chaotic behavior. That is when chaos happens. But I want to show you a situation where we concluded from theory that it will become chaotic at 3/4. So, let me put it something like 2.8. Let me see the behavior then. You see, it is stable, right? It started from here and went around and finally converged. Let us see what happens as you increase the parameter. still stable, but the rate of convergence is less. Very less. See, it goes out, but then it converges onto a period 2 orbit here. See, this point and that point, these two values constitute a period 2 orbit. It toggles between the two, right? And this orbit is stable. If you start from any other initial condition, it will go there. Now, in order to understand this, let me go through the sequence by plotting the second composition of the map. The second composition of the map, x n plus 2 as a function of x n, had a fixed point which is stable, right? Now, as you increase the parameter to the value that I just showed, see, it goes to this one and stays. It is a period 2 orbit, and at that point it is a, this point has become unstable and these two points have become stable. It will be clearer in view if I put it slightly bigger parameter. Okay. So, this implies that when the period 1 orbit becomes unstable, it is a inevitable result that the period 2 orbit will become stable. Okay. Now, this one, you see there is a hump here. As you increase the parameter, this hump will also go through the same sequence. If I change the parameter, increase the parameter further, so somewhere it will also go through the same sequence. What we earlier saw, that there was a hump and this point was stable and then it became unstable at some parameter value, exactly the same thing is going to happen. And then what is going to happen, what happened in period 1 orbit became a period 2, exactly the same thing is going to happen here, which means it will lead to a period 4 orbit. When that becomes unstable, it will lead to period 4, 8 orbit. So, it will lead to a period doubling cascade. And period doubling cascade inevitably leads to chaos. Clear? So, that is the essential mechanism of production of chaos. I will show you that chaos. I'll go to the period first composition of the map, and there you can easily see chaos. Depending on how many iterations you plot, if you plot a larger number of iterations, you see a complete field up. Each point is falling in a different place. So, it has become a full blown chaotic orbit. You might notice that this kind of stuff, which are maps, are far easier to handle analytically. You can do the mathematics very simple, and that is why we more or less prefer to work with maps. And there the step is that if you have a set of differential equations, from there you have to do something to obtain the map, and then only we can work with the map. That is the tricky part. I will not deal with in detail with that tricky part, but we will try to understand things in terms of maps. Okay, so now let me go back to where I was. This is what I just illustrated. If you have a two dimensional map, then what? Then you have x n plus 1 is a function of x n y n, y n plus 1 is another function of x n y n, and so you have this as a two dimensional map. Now, here also you have to obtain the fixed point, you have to obtain the stability. In order to obtain the fixed point, all you need to do is to put x1, xn plus 1 is equal to xn, yn plus 1 is equal to yn, and exactly the same way that we did for differential equations, at the equilibrium point, at the fixed point, you have to locally linearize it by the Jacobian matrix, thereby obtain this map. It is a linear map, right? And the linear map stability is obtained in terms of the Jacobian, which we already did. So, here also exactly the same thing will pertain, only difference is that in this case you will be able to identify the eigenvalues, eigenvectors. Suppose these are the two eigenvectors, and suppose the eigenvalues are negative. Presently assume that not negative, assume them to be positive and less than 1. What will happen? What does it mean? It means that if you start from this point, this vector will be multiplied by a number which is less than 1, and therefore it will be a vector smaller than this but in the same direction, and therefore it will map to this point to this point. If you take this point and do the same operation again, it will map to this point, and as a result it will go tick 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 and ultimately converge onto the fixed point. It will create a sequence of numbers which are convergent sequence, and that will converge onto the fixed point. If the eigenvalue is bigger than 1 and positive, then it will go tick 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 go out, because every iterate this magnitude of the vector will be multiplied by a number which is bigger than 1. So, it will go out. So, that is a unstable behavior. This is called a stable node, this is called an unstable node. What if in one direction it is stable, the another direction is unstable, which means that in one direction one eigenvalue is bigger than 1, another eigenvalue is one eigenvalue is bigger than 1, another eigenvalue is smaller than 1, then it will be convergent in one direction, it will be divergent in another direction, ultimately it will go like this. It will be, this is a saddle. So, all the thing that we learnt in case of differential equations will apply here, but with slight difference. There the condition was essentially related to the real part of the eigenvalue being positive or negative. Here it is whether the magnitude is bigger than or smaller than 1. Yeah, if it is greater than 1, then this vector will be multiplied by a number which is bigger than 1, and it will become this vector.
Second time
it will be even more than that, so on and so forth. Okay, yeah, you are right, you are right. This picture is a bit wrong, it will be bigger and bigger, you are right, yeah. What if the eigenvalues are negative? Then say it is starting from this vector, it will be multiplied by a number which is negative, and therefore it will jump to the other side, it will flip to the other side, and then depending on the magnitude, if it is smaller than or bigger than 1, either it will converge or diverge. But the important point is that if the eigenvalues are negative, it flips. So, therefore, this kind of a fixed point is called a regular attractor, this one is called a regular repeller, this point is called this type is called a regular saddle. This is called a flip saddle, flip, because it flips from two sides, between two sides. Now, if the eigenvalues are complex, then what? Then a vector is multiplied by a complex number, right? What happens if a vector is multiplied by a complex number? It turns. It turns. It becomes elongated or shortened by the magnitude of that complex number, and the angle by which it turns is just tan inverse minus b by a. So, if the modulus of the complex number is bigger than 1, it will be an outgoing spiral. If it is smaller than 1, it will be incoming spiral, so on and so forth. Rather simple stuff. So, the local dynamics can be like this. Local dynamics can be like this. And that immediately leads to the conclusion that there can be only three basic type of bifurcations. One, because the bifurcations are caused by eigenvalues leaving the unit circle, magnitude becoming from smaller than 1 to bigger than 1 is eigenvalue leaving the unit circle. And there are three ways in which it can leave, either on the negative real line or positive real line or complex conjugate. Three possibilities. Let us look at the three possibilities. If it leaves at the negative real line, then it is just a period W bifurcation, but we saw already. If it is goes this way in a positive direction, positive real values, then it is a saddle node bifurcation, which we have seen already. And if a pair of complex conjugate eigenvalues leave, then something interesting happens. Let me illustrate that on the board. When it was inside, if this is the fixed point, you start from here, how will it behave? Complex conjugate eigenvalue modulus smaller than 1, it will spiral inwards, but not in a continuous motion, but in jumping motion, right? So it will be like this. Right? If so, this is where the lambda is. Now, what will happen if the lambda magnitude is bigger than 1? Suppose this is the fixed point, I start from here, what will it do? It will go out. Go out in what way? Spiraling way. So it will go like this, so and so forth, and go to infinity. No, because we are dealing with the nonlinear system, and when we are talking about this, we have taken the Jacobian, taken the local linear neighborhood, and then talking about that. What happened in case of the differential equation system? Yes, so there we concluded that whatever we are concluding regarding this is only a local linear neighborhood. It need not be applicable everywhere. So if it becomes from a incoming spiral to outgoing spiral, there is a possibility that a closed loop will develop in between, right? So it can be that at some distance it is still incoming, but here it becomes outgoing, so a closed loop will develop in between. What is a closed loop in discrete time? What is a closed loop in discrete time? What does it represent physically? A torus. A torus in continuous time. You have placed a Poincare section, you see a closed loop, means it is a torus, right? So a torus, the natural question was that how does a torus develop? A torus behavior, how does it develop in a nonlinear system? This way. So the way that a torus develops, torus behavior develops, is this way, where you place a Poincare section, observe the behavior of the equilibrium point. That equilibrium point, it had a complex conjugate pair of eigenvalues, and that complex conjugate pair had a negative, had a modulus that is smaller than 1, that became bigger than 1, that is what produces a torus. So this is what produces the torus. Now let us go to an example. This is the map. Should we do it in the tutorial? What time the tutorial starts? 4 o'clock. 4:30. Oh, in between is there a break? 4 to 4:30. Okay, good. We'll take it up. Should we take it up in the? Yeah, we'll take it up in the tutorial. No, let's do it here. We'll take something else in the tutorial, because you need to see how it's done. Then only you'll be able to fill it up. Okay. So this is, suppose this is the map given. It's called a Hinon map. It represents the motion of an asteroid in a dual attraction of Sun and Jupiter. And if you place a Poincare section, then its representation is something like this. Here there is a parameter A, right? So the map is given by xn plus 1 is a function of x and y, yn plus another function of x and y, in this case only x. And then first thing that you do is to obtain the fixed point. Obtain the fixed point. Fixed points are obtained by putting xn and xn plus 1 and xn equal, and then solving it. So if you do that, you get these as the equilibrium point. and y star is same as x star. So, the position of the equilibrium point contains A. Now, tell me, what do you infer by looking at, just looking at this? You can infer under what condition it will exist, under what condition it will not. Clear, immediately clear that it will exist only under certain condition, otherwise it will not. That is the condition for saddle node bifurcation. I said that under certain condition it does not exist and then it starts to exist is the saddle node bifurcation. And we know from theory that both a saddle and a node must be created, obviously, because there is plus minus. So, you have this as a condition under which does not exist, and then there are two fixed points that exist. Good. The natural question next is, are they stable? How do you look at that? In order to look at that, we need to obtain the Jacobian matrix. The Jacobian matrix of this function is easy to get, which I have just written, and which you will also do in the tutorial, because this I will give as a tutorial also. So, and the eigenvalues you obtain is like this. So, the eigenvalue contains the position of the fixed point. You now need to plug in the position of the fixed point. As you plug in, the solution has the same value, this value. This value is put in here, giving the value of the lambda. And then you find that one fixed point is saddle, the other is node. That is why it is called a saddle node bifurcation. Okay. Two points came into existence, one a saddle, another a node. Now, if you keep on looking at the node, which is stable, then at a certain parameter value, this eigenvalue exceeds unity and therefore it becomes unstable. And how does it become unstable? The eigenvalue becomes minus 1, not plus 1, minus 1. What did I say happens when it is minus 1? Period doubling. Saddle node is when it comes to exist, right? When it becomes unstable, it is a period doubling. So, physically what happens looks something like this. There is nothing. Initially, there is no fixed point. And then at a critical parameter value, a fixed point is born, which we just derived as minus 0.09. After it is born, it is, even though it looks like 1, it is actually a collection of 2 points, both having the same value, because the plus minus root over something, that number is now 0. Therefore, both the things are the same, but as you change the parameter further, they will move apart. So, they move apart. The node is marked with the solid dot, and the empty dot is the saddle. Now, this one at some point of time becomes unstable, and then it becomes a period doubling. So, two fixed points exist, come to exist. After some time, they also become unstable, 4 fixed points come to exist, and so on and so forth. And after some time, the whole thing becomes chaotic. So, from 1 to 2 to 4 to 8 to 16 and so on and so forth, ultimately it leads to a period infinity. Notice that it has infinity of points, but it has structure. That is a hallmark of chaotic behavior. If you look at the bifurcation diagram, they can be easily identified. The first one is the saddle node bifurcation, where before that there was nothing, no fixed point, and 2 fixed points came into existence here. One is visible because that is stable, and that fixed point became unstable here, and 2 fixed points came into existence, but this one has become unstable, still exists. Okay? It goes like this. This period 2 orbit again becomes unstable here, and period 4 exists. Period 4 orbit again becomes unstable here, period 8 exists, and so on and so forth, ultimately leads to chaos. Yeah.
I don't know whether this is an optical illusion, but after period 8, it seems that the number increases very rapidly.
No, it is not optical illusion. All that happens is that the range for which each periodicity exists progressively reduces.
Oh, I see.
And then it in a very small parameter difference, it becomes period 18, period 16, period 32, period 64, and all that. This all exists for a very, very small parameter range. I'll come to that. White is something that I have raised the question, but I have not explained yet. Okay, let's handle that question. And this one I can kill now. It is done. Yes. All right. This is the bifurcation diagram for the logistic map. And I have very clear picture. I have two questions to answer. One is what happens here in this part. It looks like very in a sharp way it becomes chaotic. So I will expand that part. See, it is still a sequence of period doublings. If you want to see a small part like this, still a sequence of period doublings.
The structure also seems.
Yes, that is something that I wanted to tell you. I wanted to tell you, but before telling you, I showed you so that it automatically looks like that. It is self-similar structure. It is self-similar structure. As you go in and in, it leads to the same behavior. I just switch it on again. If you calculate the ratio of this parameter range for which period 4 exists and this parameter range for which period 2 exists, you get a ratio. This parameter range for which period 8 exists and period 4 exists, you get a ratio. And this ratio also converges to a number. This is called the Feigenbaum ratio. And that is why it looks so self-similar. Okay, now question, what are these white patches? Let's expand it and see what is there. It's a period 3 orbit. So suddenly a chaos gives rise to a period 3 orbit, which also goes through period doubling cascade and goes into chaos. So natural question, where does the period 3 orbit come from? Natural question, let's face it. Okay, so in order to face this question, let me take the graphical iterate of this one. And okay, let's see where it was. No, it was somewhere here. Here. What was the parameter value? Around 3.83, slightly less than that. Let's start with 3.82. At that parameter value, let's look at the graph of the map and see what does it say. 3.82, you said? Okay. It will be a nice chaotic behavior. Okay. Now, 3.83. See, after some initial transient, it converts into a period 3 behavior. Right? How and why? There must be a mathematical reason behind it, right? Let's look at it. It's a period 3 behavior. Therefore, in order to probe it, we have to look at the third composition of the map, xn plus 3 as a function of xn. So, if I want to see that, I will take the third composition of the map, I will go back to the old parameter value and look at the third composition, 3, and I'll rather stop it. Notice that the third composition has this structure and it comes very close to the 45 degree line in here and in here, but has not yet touched. So, it sort of goes through and covers the whole place, but I can easily see that as I change the parameter, it is going to touch and this is nothing but the same saddle knot bifurcation we have seen earlier. We have seen that 45 degree line, a graph of the map like this and then it intersects, exactly the same thing is going to happen, right? Exactly the same thing will happen. See, it is intersected and we have this point stable. It is a third iterator of the map, therefore, every three iterates it comes up with the same value. So, this is the mechanism by which you get that gap. It is a period 3 orbit, but it is immediately clear that this part of the graph is similar to the original graph, right? And therefore, whatever happened to the original graph should happen to this part also. After some time, this guy is going to also going to be unstable. When it becomes unstable, it was a period 3 orbit, it will period double, it will be in period 6, that will also period double will become period 12, so on and so forth. And so, it will give rise to a sequence. See, here is the whole sequence. Oh, sorry, I'll kill it and start over again. In this range, you have the whole sequence of period 3, period 6, period 12, which did not exist here. Notice that here what was created was a multiple of 2, 2 to 4 to 8 to 16, that sequence does not include 6. This had a large number of unstable periodic orbit, but not all. There is a theorem due to Shaskovsky who proved that in this periodic window, before that all the periodic behavior, see, after this, the period 1 orbit is there, unstable, but is there, exists. After this point, this period 1 orbit is there, period 2 is there, period 4 is there. After this point, period 1, period 2, period 4, period 8, they are all there. So, as you go around, all the periodicities are existing, but some are stable or all are unstable in chaos. But then, as you go around, go forward, after this window, all periodicities are there. There is a mathematical theorem that says that called Sharkovsky's theorem that all periodicities are there, and this is called full blown chaos. All periodicities are there. What does it mean? It means something profound. It means that when I say chaos, a chaotic behavior means it has in it embedded an infinite number of unstable periodic orbits. An infinite number of unstable periodic orbits are embedded inside a chaotic orbit. Each is unstable, but if you start from a very close neighborhood of that, it will go around that very close to it for some time and then it will move away. And nowadays, there is a mechanism by which we can control any of these. So, notice how much flexibility it offers. A normal system, if you design it to be periodic, it just periodically goes. Yet, if you design a chaotic system, then it has all periodicities, all behaviors embedded in it. You can stabilize any one of them. There are wonderful ways of stabilization. If there is time, I will tell you about that. Wonderful ways of stabilization of these orbits. And these are fantastically used in fantastic places. For example, when the heart becomes unstable, there have been experiments by which the frog heart, I mean, we are not allowed to do it on human heart, the frog heart, when there is a ventricular fibrillation, that could be stabilized using this technique. Okay, so now let me go to where I was in the, yeah, this one. Now let us see what happens when a pair of complex conjugate eigenvalues become pair of complex eigenvalues become unstable. So then you see that there was a earlier a incoming spiraling orbit converging onto a fixed point, and that becomes a closed loop, and that closed loop is essentially representative of a torus. Okay. So a torus with a Poincare section, on the Poincare section we will see a closed loop. So if you see a closed loop on a discrete time map, it means that in a physical system it has developed a quasi periodic orbit. So let us stop here, and now let us do some problems. Okay. Is a graphical iteration. Do the graphical iteration. How does the map looks like? And then you graphically iterate. And by graphical iteration, tell us what the behavior will be.
how will you go? From here, you will first go to the graph of the map, go to the 45 degree line, go to the graph of the map, go to the 45 degree line, go to the graph of the map, go to the 45, so on and so forth. I want to, you to do this. Practice how to do the graphical iteration. Practice how you do the graphical simply by looking at the fixed point, right? Obtain the condition for the fixed point, the expression of which fixed point, and from there you can infer. So where is the fixed point? Yeah, but what is the fixed point? So x star. What is the expression of that? So under what condition this fixed point will exist and under what condition it will not exist? It's clear that from here. The condition under which this is a complex number is the range for which it will not exist. And at, I can see that at a is equal to
1.4,
it will point to 5, it will the settlement point. How will it occur? It's like this. At this point, the cellular bifurcation occurs. And after that, it becomes like this. There are two fixed points.
clear, this to extent. But then here, you substitute the points. That particular point you substitute here, and that will tell you. Now here, I can see that this guy has a is already unstable. This cannot go through a Peter doubling pattern. Only this guy can. So out of the two numbers, the smaller number will have. That's clear. So just substitute this smaller number, the minus one, put here, and then we find out the condition. So, now do the math that I just showed you. Thank you. Saddle node bifurcation I had calculated, and then now 0.27 I got.
Okay.